been a long time.
I know, it's been a long time.
So how you been? Pretty good. Couple nights. No major incident.
Just bring one.
It was an ordeal. I spent 2 hours on the line.
I guess it's not up yet.
So it's not. 6:30 to 8:30.
Did you
make it
for me?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Just barely.
Oh my gosh.
I came here and changed, but the camera's really like through this.
Crazy. Wow, yeah. Plane travel is just. Yeah, it's that one out of every 3 trips has some major.
And all the planes are so proud of
them. Yeah.
To try and pack it to land.
Right.
So.
I'm glad you came here.
Yeah.
Okay, just quickly, I want to welcome you all to our second panel, New Frameworks for Understanding Race and Public Policy, and to introduce our moderator, who will introduce our panelists. Our moderator is Professor Deva Prager. Thanks for coming. She is an associate professor of sociology and a faculty associate in the Office of Population Research here at Princeton University. Her research focuses on institutions affecting racial stratification, including education, labor markets, and the criminal justice system. Professor Pager's current research has involved a series of field experiments studying discrimination against minorities and ex-offenders in the low-wage labor market. Her book, Marked Race, Race, Crime, and Finding Work in an Era of Mass Incarceration, investigates the racial and economic consequences of large-scale imprisonment for contemporary U.S. labor markets. As well as a separate line of work, Pager spent a year in Paris on a Fulbright grant studying changes in crime policy and its relationship to patterns of immigration and ethnic tension in contemporary France. Professor Pager holds master's degrees from Stanford and the University of Cape Town and a PhD from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Thanks for being here.
Pleasure. Thank you. It's a real pleasure to be moderating this panel. Each of the authors here, or each of the presenters here, works on issues that are very near and dear to my heart, and I'm sure those of all of you in this room. So it's a real exciting lineup of speakers. I'll introduce each of the 3 speakers, and then we'll have them offer their comments in order. Our first speaker is Vesla May Weaver, who is an assistant professor of politics at the University of Virginia. Weaver writes on issues related to race and politics, American political development, and social policy. She is an incredibly prolific author with multiple manuscripts in various stages of production. One manuscript entitled Frontlash, Civil Rights, the Carceral State, and the Transformation of American Politics, which is under contract with Cambridge University Press, uncovers the connection between the movement for civil rights and the development of punitive criminal justice. Weaver also recently completed another book with Professor Jennifer Hochschild and Tracy Birch, which is forthcoming with Princeton University Press, called Transforming the American Racial Order, on how the growth of multiracialism, immigration, the genomics revolution, and generational changes are reshaping the racial order in the United States. And she also has a current book project with our own Professor Amy Lerman entitled Punitive State, the Creation of the American Civic Underclass, which examines how incarceration and surveillance has reshaped citizenship and changed the nature of citizens' experiences of the government. In addition, Weaver has also published in the top journals in her own cognate disciplines. She's received fellowships from the National Science Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the Brookings Institution, and was awarded the Best Dissertation Award in Race, Ethnicity, and Politics from the American Political Science Association. So welcome, Vesla. Our second panelist is Karyn Lacy, who is Associate Professor of Sociology and African American Studies at the University of Michigan. She is a Ford Fellow and was a visiting scholar at the Russell Sage Foundation. Her book, Blue Chip Black, Race, Class, and Status in the New Black Middle Class, was published with the University of California Press, and it received the Oliver Cromwell Cox Book Award from the American Sociological Association's Section on Racial and Ethnic Minorities. This book reveals the identity options of middle-class blacks in 2 suburbs of Washington, D.C., and this book has really become required reading in sociology courses on race and ethnicity and social stratification. Lacy's current work explores the construction and reproduction of racial and class-based identities among members of an elite social organization. Welcome, Karyn. And our third speaker is Naomi Murakawa, who is an assistant professor in the Department of Political Science at the University of Washington. She is broadly interested in American political development, racial politics, and crime policy in the carceral state. Her current research projects address the nationalization of crime policy during the civil rights movement, the meth epidemic, and soft entry into the carceral state through non-criminal offenses. Her book manuscript, The First Civil Right, Race and the Rise of Law and Order, is forthcoming with Oxford University Press, and it's based on her dissertation, which won the Law and Society Dissertation Prize, as well as the American Political Science Association's Best Dissertation in Race, Ethnicity, and Politics. She's received fellowships from the Columbia Law School Center for the Study of Law and Culture, as well as the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation's Health Policy Research Program, and her work has appeared in Law and Society Review, Du Bois Review, and several edited volumes. Welcome, Naomi. As you can see, we have an incredibly distinguished panel with us today, so with no further ado, I will turn the podium over to Vesla.
First, thank you so much for inviting me here, Dr. Perry and Dr. Claude and the rest of the center. I'm really excited to present this, but I'm also doubly nervous because my co-author, Amy Lerman, is in the audience. So, you know, if I mess up on any numbers, she will know and she'll point it out, or if I tell any fibs. So this project grew out of our increasing concern that as political scientists, we were completely inattentive to what we're gonna call two faces of the state. One being how the government provides for its citizens, and the other being how the government supervises and increasingly punishes and adjudicates and targets its citizens. And we became interested in figuring out, well, what does this do to blacks' sense of the state, to the way citizens operationalize their own citizenship? How do they move through American democracy when, for them, government is about control and is, as I'll show you, authoritarian? So first, some basic statistics. Over time, this is basically what has happened. The prevalence of contact with the criminal justice system is unmatched in history. But for blacks, that has become, it's become much, much more prevalent. So since 1973, the incarceration rate has increased for 35 consecutive years, multiplying by a factor of 6 by the millennium. The criminal justice system thus became a more important site than ever of government interaction with its citizens. So interactions that were increasingly likely to be those in which citizens were a subject, not a voluntary participant. But the growth traced above was uneven. Certain classes and groups and neighborhoods have been the main clientele for this sector of government activity, and policies that invested in greater surveillance and punishment had the most concentrated effect on racial minorities, and particularly the urban poor. The modal confined and surveilled citizen was a young urban black. This is what happens over time. This is the black rate of prison admissions. So the number of black people admitted to prison per 100,000 in the population. And you can see that the white increase happens as well around the same time, but it's much slower. It's a much flatter slope than the black rate of incarceration. So one group of citizens we observed, largely white, middle class, and non-urban, does not encounter the police in their daily lives, does not attend schools with probation and parole officers or police officers on its payrolls, does not fear or experience being stopped or searched, and likely will never know the inside of a cell. The other group of citizens, those that we're most concerned with in the book, are mostly black and Latino, and they call home the segregated urban pockets of disadvantaged neighborhoods of the urban core that are ecologically unmatched in blight, concentrated poverty, and violence. They move through their daily lives with the expectation and experience of police contact. They see the institutions of criminal justice on a routine basis, and I'm glad Nikki brought up that word routine this morning. And for whom the majority will experience firsthand being a suspect, convict, or inmate. these are the main citizens of the carceral state. For them, government is criminal justice. And I'm going to show you several other statistics here. This is not prison admissions. This is imprisonment. Those people sentenced to at least a year or more of prison time. And again, you can see the rate for black males increases at four times the pace of white males. Hispanics are also disproportionately imprisoned comparatively. This goes back to 1980. You can really see the sort of war on drugs impact here. Today, if you look across levels of contact, so a lot of statistics you'll see, and this is part of our emphasis in the book, focus on incarceration and imprisonment, and what we're arguing is no, it's not just confinement. It's actually routine stops by the police, things called Terry stops, where the police do not have to have probable cause. All they need is reasonable suspicion, which can be place, it can be walking through a high crime area, and it can be also include evasion, meaning turning away from cops when they approach. Today, 11% of black men in the prime of their adult lives, ages 25 to 29, are not in school, working, or buying their first houses. They're residing in America's prisons and jails. This is just on one day. If we look at the young men ages 25 to 34 who by 2001 had ever been in a state or federal prison, the number now approaches what we would call a common experience, 20%. Compared to black men, for black men, 9% for Hispanic men, compared to just 3% for white men. Such high racial disparities are relatively recent, as we can see, and they're now much more likely than any time in history blacks are, or any other social group today, to experience punishment and surveillance at the hands of the state. This next graph basically shows somewhat of the same thing. This is drawing off of Jeff Monza and Chris Uggen's data. And it basically shows that over time, blacks became twice as likely to experience incarceration or to have a felon record in 2004 as in 1968. And the two are not the same. So there's a lot of blacks who have never been to prison but have a felon conviction on their record. Okay. If we look at lifetime risk, so your lifetime risk of ever being incarcerated, a third of blacks and 17% of Latinos will at some point in their lives be confined in prison. We also wanted to show this chart, which basically gets at, because a lot of political scientists, we focus so much on other governing institutions, we focus on welfare a lot, that we sort of wanted to point out to political scientists, look, this is becoming a main way that black citizens interact with their state. If you look across different various social programs, public housing, Head Start, aid from a welfare office, the rates of receipt are not nearly as high as having this type of intervention from government. Okay, and I'll talk about these data in a little bit. Now, most people, and I don't have a whole great deal of time to go through this, but most people would be thinking, well, doesn't it have to do with black men are just more violent? They're committing more, a greater share of violent offenses, therefore, and imprisonable offenses. These disparities, that graph I showed you of really rising prison admittances for blacks, cannot be explained by blacks becoming a greater share of offenders. So, this graph is the best data that we have over time of what we could call black, or crime by race. Now, probably some of you are thinking this is a really bad measure of crime, given that arrests themselves are highly disparate, but it's the only thing we have. And if arrests can explain, if greater black arrests can explain greater black incarceration, we should see basically this line, this is the percent of black, the share of black crime. We should see this line going up right around the time that we see prison admissions going up. We don't. It's flat. Blacks have not become a greater share of offenders over time. Simply cannot explain racial disparities. Okay. Another scholar, Michael Tonry, has looked at, well, what portion of arrests can explain variation in black imprisonment? And he finds that over time, that portion explains very little variation. So, for example, for drug offenses, the share of black drug offenses that would explain black imprisonment for drugs, is only 60%. Only 60% of black imprisonment rates for drugs is explained by black arrests for drugs. We've also started to notice that there are enclaves of criminal justice contact. People in these areas are disproportionately targeted, adjudicated, and punished by the government. There's a lower class group of blacks and Latinos who are more likely to go to school, to live and go to school in areas of greater police presence. Black teens attend schools with greater, a regular probation officer on staff, et cetera. And not a single Chicago City school is without police officers, metal detectors, and routine searches of school lockers for drugs. So this shows basically concentrating, the graphs before shows you aggregate effects. This shows concentrations. So this is a picture of New York, and it maps where the prison admissions are coming from. And you can definitely see that there are certain areas where a much higher proportion of the residents of that area are being sent to prison. And the same basically goes for many of the cities in the United States. So one of the areas we interviewed in, that I'll talk about in a little bit, Charlottesville, Virginia, I've done basically the same map for that area. Shows the exact same picture. Blacker areas have higher levels of incarceration. In Texas, 7 neighborhoods in Houston received more returning prisoners than several entire counties in the entire state of Texas. In New York, 24 neighborhoods out of 200 accounted for only 16% of the city population, but were half of the entire state's budget on prison spending. Contact with criminal justice is a routine, memorable experience of government for these citizens. For many of the people we interviewed, no contact in their communities was very much exceptional. Many people didn't report knowing anybody in their network, friends, family, people they went to church with, without contact. And for many, encountering criminal justice on a weekly basis was sort of expected. So one black man, 33 years old, in Charlottesville, says to us, "You asked a question earlier. How does running in with the police in certain situations affect you? That's the wrong question for you to ask me, because I became so immune to it that it wasn't a day unless I had a run-in with the police." Okay, and he had been stopped 3 times in less than an hour the day before we interviewed him. Oh, I should mention the picture on the other side of that. Does anybody know what that was? I bet Diva remembers this. It's basically a playground. It was a playground in, I can't get back to it. It was a playground in a Brooklyn neighborhood that was painted as a jail. And it's just sort of capturing that in these neighborhoods, this was sort of expected. This was a place that kids would look forward to entering. Okay. Today I'm going to talk about our study briefly, and then I'm going to move on to the policy implications. For some reason, I skipped 2 slides here. I'll just go on. The basic argument in the book is that because citizens learn about political life through their contact, through their street-level contacts with government, and because for some black communities, the most direct contact with governing institutions is with criminal justice, we wanted to explore what lessons about government they were learning, how they see their government and their place in the democratic community. Today I'm going to make 2 bold propositions. 1, for many blacks, government is the criminal justice system. When they think about government, they are thinking about their interactions with criminal justice. When they interact with government, it's through a prison, court, police station, parole board, not city hall, not people canvassing for their vote, etc. For many blacks, this was their most direct, sometimes their only, interaction with the state. This has resulted in what we call 2 faces of the state. And I heard this morning, Mickey, you used the word life space. We're calling it a custodial life world, okay? For some citizens, this is two faces of the state, some citizens are participating in a government that responds to them, that gives them benefits and services. Others see an authoritarian government that acts on them, that restricts their movement and rights, and that they fear interactions with the government. The second proposition is that incarceration and other custodial interactions are leading to a class of disempowered, distrustful, alienated citizens who are extremely pessimistic about blacks' prospects in America, a civic underclass. Incarceration and surveillance cultivate anti-citizens. They're fearful of the state. They're withdrawn from civic society. They're mistrustful of government. In some communities, this civic underclass is likely to be the norm, pulling those with already low status and resources further from the political sphere and concentrating political alienation and marginalization along with poverty. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the consequences. My first book is on the causes of this rise in punitiveness and in incarceration. Now we're talking about the consequences for citizens. And we're drawing on several different types of data. We're first using five large, 3 minutes. Do we get extra because the people on the panel this morning took extra time?
Just hit the basketball thing.
Right, exactly. Where is that here? So we went around, we interviewed 100 people in four different cities. We have Trenton, Charlottesville, Virginia, and New Orleans, Louisiana. And our next stop is Oakland, California. And so I'm going to draw a little bit on those interviews today. And then we've also looked empirically at five different large-end data sets. The first data sets that we know of that actually measure criminal justice contact, have you been arrested, stopped, searched, etc., and perceptions of the state, trust in government, etc., and blacks' views of race. What we're arguing is that criminal justice is an important site of political and racial socialization for a growing number of Americans. And these lessons learned within the criminal justice system then sort of spill over and feed into their broader perceptions of racial prospects in America. So what I'm showing you here is the data that we're using in the large nationally representative surveys. And what we're finding is that criminal justice interventions have negative effects on core democratic attitudes and engagements. Specifically, progressive contact with criminal justice engenders mistrust of government. Okay, so this is measuring at each level the predicted probability that you distrust your government, that you report that you don't trust government. It decreases engagement in civic and political life. So again, at each stop along, at each level of encounter, we see a declining level of engagement. Even a minor encounter with the police that did not result in arrest is associated with a reduced likelihood of turning out in an election. The effects are very large for those who have been imprisoned. So only 8% of those who have served serious time behind bars, which is a year or more, report voting. We contend that the result of increasing criminal justice is a growing class of citizens with a particularly bleak view of government and citizenship, and a decreased propensity to engage in civic life. Okay, these are predicted probabilities. We've accounted for background criminality, parental background, socioeconomic status, self-control. We've accounted for a lot of things, and nothing we do can make these relationships go away. So net of all those other things, people with an involuntary punitive encounter with the state disengage, feel disempowered. So this is a measure of efficacy. Government never listens to what Americans want. Okay. Now, just as blacks' lives have been defined by other formal and informal American institutions throughout the 20th century, Jim Crow, dilapidated housing, living in city tenements, so too are many blacks' lives now demarcated by the experiences of being patted down by a cop, being led away in handcuffs, and learning the complete isolation and segregation of prison life. We're probably not surprised to learn that they feel discriminated against within criminal justice. What Amy and I have now found is that this actually broadens out, funnels out into their wider racial transcripts. So blacks who have had some sort of involuntary punitive encounter with the state feel much more pessimistic about racial equality in America, much dimmer prospects for blacks as a group. They're more likely to perceive discrimination in their own lives and in the lives of their group. Okay, so some of these, I feel like a full and equal citizen, disagreement with that goes up as you go from no contact to being stopped, arrested, or convicted. If more whites had AIDS, government would do more to find a cure. Agreement with that goes up. Again, these are predicted probabilities, so we're controlling for all kinds of background factors. Criminal justice shapes citizens' ideas not only about blacks in custody, but about the condition of blacks in America, the perceptions of their worth, standing, and citizenship. For instance, one person said, yeah, experience with the criminal justice system definitely showed me the way the world works. How much money and who your family is and what color you are determines whether you go anywhere in life, determines whether or not you get a second chance, whether or not you get any chances. Okay, so blacks with contact see more racism, feel less equal, and have very negative views of the prospects for racial equality. Here are some of the things that people told us, not in the surveys, but in our individual interviews with them. We found even starker views here. America was rife with discrimination, blacks were patently unequal, and had no faith in the American dream because government would purposefully hold blacks back. For instance, one group of New Orleans, three guys in their early 20s, told us this. At the same time, it ain't changed. It's like we slaved in a different way, the prison system slave. It's a way of being a good slavery. You a legal slave now, once you go to prison, because you're working for free, picking their crops, doing everything, cleaning up the highway. That's what they were doing. Might not be getting whipped physically, but mentally you getting whipped. Another woman described the system as a more gentler version of genocide. That's the way the system wants it. It's just a more gentler form of genocide to me. It helps keep the procreation down for the black race. And she's responding to our question of why do you think more black men are incarcerated? I think this country fears black males. So you keep them corralled and you keep them locked up. You keep their spirits broken. And finally, another man in Trenton whose name was Silas, he was an older black gentleman, said, legislators have figured out, and he couldn't vote, or he believed he couldn't vote. I actually think he can vote, because in the state of New Jersey, you're allowed to vote after you're off parole. He had one conviction and believed he couldn't vote. Legislators have figured out, well, this is how we hold the black people back. This is how we can keep them down. And what better way to control over voting than to come up with a system where you can't vote? What other way to control jobs than to come up with a system where you can't get a job because we can use your past against you? What other way to control housing than to say, hey, unfortunately, we can't take you in housing because you have a criminal record? So we saw again and again and again that their experiences in criminal justice shaped their wider views of what it meant to be a black citizen in the United States. They referred back to criminal justice as a central blockage to that progress. And what we're concerned about is that this is a very large group of citizens who don't see an America that is free, democratic, equal, where government is responsive to their claims, where they can talk about the bad things happening in their communities and government will respond. And I'll just mention one other trend we saw that was also quite shocking to Amy and I, because we thought, oh, maybe we'll find that citizens withdraw from civic life. They just kind of don't vote because they don't feel that they're allowed to. But in fact, we found that citizens who had had this kind of contact feared the state. They feared repercussions or reprisals if they went to a governing official with a demand. So we had several people that were owed disability claims. They were 2 months behind in getting their welfare payments. And they said, no, I'm not going to go protest it because I don't know what's going to come down on me. They might try and find some way of taking something away from me. I know this criminal justice system here fairly well. In this system, you need to stay out of it as much as you can. And not even that. You need to keep your head low, because the system will grab you anyway, just on its own. And we saw a lot of people that felt that they needed to keep below the radar, keep out of sight, don't make demands. Another person said, but no, have I ever tried to contact a senator or governor? No. I feel like they're not interested in what I have to say. I feel like if I contact a senator or governor, they'll probably want to put me in jail and leave me as a troublemaker. I'm serious. That's how I actually feel. Better stay below the radar, because this guy's trying to start trouble. Now again, keep in mind what I said. They have the money and the power. Who in the hell am I? I'm just a small peon at the bottom of the totem pole. And on and on and on. We saw this again and again and again. So not only are the very people that are facing arguably the most problems in their lives, they're living in areas of blight and vacant housing, they're having trouble accessing benefits, but they also don't feel like they can go to the state to make any claims because of their criminal justice background. So Amy and I have talked, I'll just end on one quick note. I had three more slides about what we should do, but maybe you'll have to wait for the book. One program I wanted to highlight was justice reinvestment. In all of the programs we searched for, so what is out there that can help, you know, ameliorate racial disparities? What's out there that can help reengage people that have been pushed out of the Democratic project? And we found almost zilch. But one thing that we do think is promising, because most of the discussion in this area is not on how to keep people out of prison, it's how to make their transition back into society a little bit gentler. So one thing we did find that we think is addressing the how do we address no entry versus re-entry is called justice reinvestment. And what it proposes to do is to take the savings to work with localities and states to say, hey, you want to decarcerate, we're going to help you. Here's what you do. You move, you stop sending people back to prison for parole violations. So they've done that in a little bit in New Jersey and other states. You stop doing this, that, and the other. Then they take the savings from doing that, the savings it takes to incarcerate people, $40,000 a year for one person, multiplied by a 3-year sentence, say. And they reinvest it in community-based organizations. And those community-based organizations can then work on affordable housing. It's like a special voucher that those groups then get to use to improve communities, which then has the incentive not only of helping employers hire ex-offenders, it also helps increase public safety in those communities in the long run by dampening the criminogenic conditions that lead to crime and violence in the first place. Thank you. Sorry I ran a little bit early.
I may just select one of these other PowerPoint slides and talk about that. Let's see how I get this to be. I'm technologically challenged. I may need some help here to get it to come up as a slideshow.
Mm-hmm. Your forward is here and your back
I want to thank Cass and for inviting me and organizing this conference, and also for Imani for doing the work to get us here, and Jennifer, who's continuing to do the work to make sure that we can pull this off. I want to talk a little bit about the problem of ambiguity in our understanding of who is or is not a member of the middle class. And we've all heard politicians stand up and say, I'm going to fight for the middle class. They never say what that group is or who it is that they're referring to. And that kind of ambiguity actually works well for politicians, because they want the person who makes only $25,000 a year to say, yes, that's my guy, I'm going to vote for him, he's going to fight for me. And they also want the person who makes as much as $75,000 or $85,000 or $90,000 a year to also feel that's the guy who's going to fight for me, or gal who's going to fight for me. So that kind of ambiguity works well for politicians, doesn't work so well for academics, as those of you who have attempted to study the middle class may have already realized. There's too much fuzziness among academics in our conception of who belongs in this category and who doesn't. And as a result, we're making a lot of mistakes in the kinds of conclusions that we're drawing about middle class people and their life chances. So ultimately, what I'm hoping to do is to design a model to try to clear up some of that fuzziness. I won't promise you that that is going to happen today, but I will give you some of the background information that will help us to get there. So I started to think about this issue of ambiguity in our definition of the middle class when I conducted the research for a book that I wrote about this group. And I started out differently than anyone else who has studied the black middle class. I really did go where no ethnographer had been before. I went to the census and looked deliberately for communities in which the median income was over $50,000 a year. Most of the existing ethnographic studies of the black middle class used a model in which income was either 2 to 4 times the poverty level, or their basis for income was the national median family income in the country. But that number, right around $40,000 at the time that I was conducting the study, seemed like a very low barometer for middle class status, particularly if you think of a family income as the salary of both a husband and a wife, roughly about $20,000 each, from my view, did not constitute membership in the middle class. So I looked at two suburbs in the Washington metro area. These are pseudonyms. Lakeview is located in Fairfax County. If you know anything about Fairfax County, there are about 3 black people in Fairfax County, really about 3% black. It's a majority white community. There's a growing Asian population, but not many blacks. Riverton is also a pseudonym for a suburban community in Prince George's County. I started out with just these two communities, and initially I was interested in how it is that people who presumably have enough money to live wherever they want end up in either a black suburb or a white suburb. And in the course of doing this research, I stumbled upon the third community, Sherwood Park, which is nestled in Riverton. And it turns out that this is an upper middle class community by everybody's standard. Everybody in the community, people who lived in Sherwood Park and people who lived in the broader Riverton subdivisions, all acknowledge this community as an elite black community. So having stumbled upon this community opened up new possibilities in terms of how to think about the analysis that I could do. Initially, I was interested in two communities that simply varied in terms of their racial composition. But here I had stumbled upon something really wonderful, which is the opportunity to also analyze differences by class. So there are two fault lines, not just one. The data collection is individual interviews with 30 black middle class couples, and also ethnographic observation. I went to all of the things that people in this community tend to do. I went to church, I went to PTA meetings, I went to block parties, I went to the grocery store to see if they sell arugula. Everything that they do, I did. And I also went undercover as a home seeker and pretended to be searching for a home in Fairfax County and in PG. I was terrified to do this. I was very worried. I'm not a good actor. I was very worried that my story would fall apart. But in any case, I did it. Okay. So among the questions that collecting this kind of data allowed me to pursue is this issue of how to think differently about the Black middle class. And the prevailing view in this literature is that the Black middle class is unstable. It's a group that faces many perils. Their neighborhoods are crime-ridden. Their neighborhoods are characterized by poor municipal services, inferior school systems, and that the average middle-class Black person lives in a neighborhood that is in very close proximity to poor people. They're the poor people on their block or in the surrounding blocks. But the group that I was analyzing for this study didn't look like those conventional groups at all. So I started to think about who are these people, who are these what I call blue chip Blacks, and what are their attributes? Okay, this table is a little fuzzy. This is the free version. If you want to see a clearer table, you have to buy the book. But I will explain it to you, that the main point that I want to convey from this table. So what I've done here is to break the Black middle class down into gradations. So you see that there is a lower middle class. These are the categories here. Lower middle class, the income category is 30,000 to 49,999. A middle class income ranges from 50,000 to 99,999, and then what I'm calling an upper middle class, which is, this is individual income, not family income, individuals who earn over $100,000 a year. And what you see is that in both cases, the lower middle class makes up the majority of the population. Among whites, 53% of the white middle class population is actually lower middle class, people who earn what we would probably consider not much money. Among Blacks, 65% of the middle class Black population is lower middle class. So whether we're talking about whites or Blacks, the lower middle class category is the modal category. And we also see among the middle class, what I call the middle class category, about 35% of the middle class white population earns just under $100,000, and about 31% of the Black middle class population does, and so forth. Okay, so it turns out that where you fall in terms of these categories matters quite a bit. So you can already see that when scholars say, I'm talking about the Black middle class, they've already made a huge mistake, right? Because we see some of the key differences between these two groups already just looking at income. Okay, so what are some of the other differences between these three groups of middle class people? This is a histogram, a set of histograms that shows us the percentage of whites and blacks within these middle class categories who are homeowners. And this is important because for most people, their home is the most important thing that they own. For many people, it's their only source of wealth. So we want to be clear about how much of middle class status contributes to the potential for home ownership. So it turns out that among whites, about 70% of people in the lower middle class category are homeowners. If we look at the comparables for blacks, about 52% of blacks in the lower middle class category are homeowners. Now, you may be thinking that's a pretty dramatic differential between black and white lower middle class people. But what I want to draw your attention to is how these differentials narrow as we move up middle class categories, right? So there's more inequality in terms of home ownership among lower middle class people by race than there is among upper middle class people by race. So we might think of, if we think of home ownership as one indicator of wealth, we might think of this chart as suggesting that the wealth gap narrows as we move up these middle class configurations. Okay, we might also think about how where you fall in terms of these middle class categories affects your residential location. And we've talked quite a bit, some this morning, about the wealth gap. There is also what I've called a place of residence gap that we hear much less about. This chart shows us the percentages of people who live in suburbs versus central cities. And this matters because we think of suburbs as a type of utopia for middle class, often white people, right? So who is it among the middle class who lives in suburbs? And this is a little tiny, so it may help you out here. The purple section is the percentage of people within each of these groups who lives in suburbs. And we see here too that there is less of a differential between blacks and whites, suburban residents, once we get to the highest category of middle class status. Now, I know you may be thinking, why should I really care about middle class people? After all, there are a lot of poor people in the country. Shouldn't we be talking about them? So I realize that this is a tough sell, but there are also some good reasons to think about the kind of stratification that I've been illustrating here among the middle class. And one good reason is that this category of lower middle class people, people who earn just under $50,000 a year, have been doing all the right things, all of the things that we tell them that they should do. You should work hard, you should get an education, you should try to own a home. So they've been following the rules, but they're still falling behind, as we can see from just these two histograms that I've been showing you here. So this group isn't really receiving the rewards that should accompany a middle class status, if we believe the hype. And this group is also the group that most studies about the black middle class are drawn on. Okay, so we're using this group to generalize and draw conclusions about the middle class population as a whole. And what I've been suggesting today is that this group really doesn't represent a true middle class in terms of their lifestyle and access to goodies. And then secondly, this kind of differentiation matters because I think that while I've focused on home ownership as an indicator of wealth and what I've called the place of residence gap, I think that this model also could matter for other kinds of social income outcomes. So earlier today, we were talking about the black-white gap, the achievement gap. And I suspect I'm trying to convince Carol and Angel will work on this with me. I haven't persuaded them yet. But I think that if we were to break the middle class down into these kinds of configurations, as opposed to just looking at one monolithic group of middle class black people, that we might actually see movement in terms of the achievement gap. Another indicator is health outcomes. There's lots of research now on the relationship between income and people's access to quality health care and the kinds of diseases that people are susceptible to. And I think, again, that if we were to impose this model on those kinds of data, that we might also find encouraging results. And if we were to brainstorm until, 6:37, in this room about this. I'm sure that we could come up with other indicators too of life chances that in which this model would also be useful.
Thank you for inviting me. It's really a pleasure to be here. I've learned a tremendous amount today. And I have to confess, I read the invitation a little bit as an invitation to editorialize. And I'm taking that invitation. So the policy domain I want to talk about is federal crime policy. And this is a policy history marked by well-known and exceptionally ugly racial watersheds, from Barry Goldwater's references to civil rights protesters as street criminals and marauders, to Reagan's renewed war on drugs and enactment of the 100-to-1 powder to crack penalties, to Bush Sr.'s infamous Willie Horton campaign. And from this policy history, it's not surprising that explanations focus on mass incarceration as the policy victory of racially conservative forces, in particular, the triumph of Republicans who strategically used crime as a cover for policies of racial retrenchment. And while it's no doubt true that mass incarceration serves racially conservative interests, I think we miss some of the more important lessons of race and public policy if we take this present-day victorious definition of law and order and search only for the racially conservative contribution. The present-day version of law and order, which is noted as punitive, focused on the racially and economically marginalized while insistently individualized and colorblind, this doctrine represents only one possible doctrine of law and order. And by accepting this definition and reading history backwards, looking for similarly valenced policies of punishment, we risk missing the ways that race liberals contributed to building the carceral state. And from this opening, I think it becomes clear that the epic policy transformations around crime of the last half century were not only transformations of more criminalization, more policing, more prisons, which they were, but they were also policies of more procedures, more guidelines, more regulations, from Miranda rights to sentencing guidelines, many crafted by race liberals with the goal of generating a system of racial fairness. And from this starting point, I argue that the development of federal crime policy was not only the victory of race conservatives, it was also a liberal project to proceduralize, to professionalize, to modernize the carceral state with aspirations and success of building what I call the civil rights carceral state. Like race conservatives, liberal interests developed in the shadow of civil rights. And from this reading, where I centralize race liberals, I want to offer three very broad punchlines of race and public policy, each illustrated with a small piece of history from the liberals I focus on, which are Truman Democrats, Johnson Democrats, and Clinton Democrats. These punchlines are intended to be provocative, far grander than I can confirm, but I think they might be synthetically connected to what we've learned today, not only of the legacies of Jim Crow, but of the continued enforcement of Jim Crow through other names such as tracking and Terry arrests. So the first editorial point. Policy racialization is not the problem. There is no way in which racialization of a policy area is axiomatically connected with policies becoming more punitive, more paltry, or more stingy. Racialization itself has no political valence. In particular, the damages of crime policy are not attributable to some new racialization that, I don't know, miraculously happened, I guess, in the 1960s, where apparently it was some new idea that black people are supposed to be associated with criminality. But it wasn't only that idea, but it was also that crime was racialized throughout by Truman and Johnson Democrats with a notion that fair criminal justice was actually part of their larger commitment to federal civil rights. And this is where the title of my book comes from, The First Civil Right. which for scholars of crime policy, the phrase the first civil right is generally attributed to Nixon's 1968 presidential campaign, where the voiceover suggested that it's time for an honest look at the problem of order in the United States, but there is no cause that justifies resort to violence. Let us recognize that the first civil right of every American is to be free from domestic violence. And with this, the famous images of scenes that are not named, but supposed to be scenes of urban rioting, and my favorite, this image on the right of a machine that says change, and there's just rubble all around it, as if this is the price we pay for enactment of civil rights, and we must re-remember what the first civil right actually is post the 1964-65 transformation. But there is an earlier and competing liberal declaration of the first civil right, and I call this the first civil right, where liberal democratic commitments to law and order were articulated here by Truman's Presidential Committee on Civil Rights. And in this vision, the first civil right implicated the criminal justice system itself as a central perpetrator of violence. Here, the first condition of essential rights was the right to safety and security of persons, including, and this is actually quite remarkable, protection from illegal violence, but also protection from the legal violence of police brutality and courts that do not provide equal protection under the law. And this is an image of the four essential rights that was drawn from the Committee on Civil Rights that shows the first civil right, safety and security of person, followed by voting rights, freedom of conscience and religion, and freedom of and equal opportunity. This idea was part of a new liberal and mostly white liberal post-war conventional wisdom, with the idea that inequality causes violence. In particular, in post-war conventional wisdom, the lynching of black veterans and the riots of 1943 were exposing white violence as increasingly unacceptable by national standards, but just as importantly, it was embarrassing by international standards. So interracial liberal organizations, such as the American Council of Race Relations, articulated the view that violence is but the tip of the iceberg of a larger problem of racial inequality, discrimination, and segregation. So this is a moment of a racializing the crime problem, but racializing it in a way that is actually intended to bring to the forefront white violence as it is connected to a larger system of racial inequality. So from this, I'll give my second big theme, which is that commitment to abstracted principles of racial liberalism actually distort policy commitments. So I think the failure of liberal lawmakers in Congress was not that they racialized crime policy. I actually think a lot of these earlier claims might be some of the best official claims that we get in the 20th century. Their failure was not racialization. It was that they took a racialized problem and addressed it with deracializing solutions. In short, the commitment to race neutrality trumped any commitment to racial justice, which is, I'm not sure the commitment to racial justice was ever that deep, but the commitment to racial neutrality was truly what defined the day. So liberal crime policy proposals, what was coming out of the Democratic Party through the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, entailed all that would become the earmarks of federal civil rights. There was an emphasis on procedure, on individual intent and individualized punishment, and on sustaining the innocence of institutional structures through minor legal and policy fixes. So what started, or what, I'll say, what could have been a democratic agenda for justice was mostly articulated as a set of policy proposals for modernizing the criminal justice state, with the hope that layering it with money and procedures could actually wring the racism out of it just through more and more federal state building. The statement from Robert Carr from 1947, the administration of justice, violence, and intimidation, and lynching are all cut from the same cloth, potentially offers a radical opening, but instead we get predominantly three sets of proposals among others, which are the Democratic Party is going to fight for criminal procedure, it's going to fight for police professionalization, and for limits on disparity in judicial sentencing. In each of these, I think that the problem with liberal lawmakers We tend to think the problem was that they lost to conservatives. I actually think part of the problem was that they won. They just won all of the wrong things for all of the wrong reasons. In particular, their battle for funding police as a project of professionalization was marked as a problem not only of wringing the racism out of police, but doing so explicitly for generating a kind of legitimacy that was hoped to bring greater calm. Not justice, but calm. So this image here is from the 1943 Detroit riots, and it was reprinted in a number of black newspapers. It shows a black man whose name I couldn't find actually in any of the articles, being held by two white police officers as a white mob sort of surrounds him, and the caption was commonly, "Police officers hold a black man while a white man slaps his face." Now, the reason this was interesting to me is not just that it cropped up here, but that it cropped up in so many of the files of the archives that I went through in the Truman archives, with notation that this was not only bad, but more importantly, this really looked bad. This is a dangerous photograph to have circulating about. And this would, in Nash's files, this was attached to a memo that listed all of the racial strife of 1919, the end of, after the closing of the First World War, with a notation that in this international context, in the context of these claims, if we don't start correcting images like this, there could be massive swelling, right? Massive swelling of discontent. And so what do they need to do? Answer what this looks like, right? Answer the legitimacy that is in peril with images like these. So, and you can hear these kinds of demands for legitimacy through greater state building in a variety of liberal policy documents, including the original Presidential Committee on Civil Rights, which suggested that the federal government needs to give more money to fund police training and needs to give higher salaries to police officers to indoctrinate officers with the awareness of civil rights problems and to teach them proper treatment of the arrested and the incarcerated. The report also added that training along with higher salaries would attract and hold a more competent personnel, which would make the police genuinely professional. This theme continues through the 1961 report from the U.S. Civil Rights Commission that noted in particular federal money was important to end the reality of racist, well, might help to end the reality of racist policing, but it was equally important to end the perception of racist policing, in particular to end the association of police departments with KKK memberships by getting just sort of a higher caliber of people. And with Johnson's final Crime Commission report that came out in 67, and it was indeed liberal Democrats that put forward the proposals for massive federal monies for police departments. The argument was that federal money would nourish and engender trust amongst populations. Now, any criminologist would tell you it's actually probably true that you do need the trust of communities to get people to call when a crime is committed and to come do some investigation. But it was striking to me just how explicit the demand was for, in some ways, not answering the reality of racist policing, but providing enough of a professional cover so that there's legitimacy and stability. I'm going to give a third editorial point. This is the long and weaker stated one is liberal commitments to abstract racial fairness are easily decoupled from any reference point to an external good. A less wordy way of putting that is procedural fairness legitimizes substantive racism. And I think that you find this dynamic of politics happening, that was a smile, happening most keenly amongst Clinton Democrats. And here I want to give one example of death penalty legislation and how it was established at the federal level, in which we get a congressional escalation from the number of capital crimes. There were only two in 1988 to 64 in 1994. And there's a very particular way that we landed on the number 64. So if you look at the proposals and the sequence in which the proposals were introduced, it's notable that the proposals go up in terms of numbers of crimes punishable by death, with each proposal introduced by a competing party member, with inventories of punitiveness. And with Democrats not only stating outright that they are happy to abandon the Racial Justice Act, but Biden actually calling a press conference to say, I'm happy to abandon the Racial Justice Act, and I'm so pleased to deliver the bad news to the Congressional Black Caucus myself. That, alongside saying the Democratic Party has fought more for the procedural safety of those under trial more than anyone else. So we can engage in this kind of substantive behavior because we've already protected the procedural rights. In other words, you really must be guilty if you're there. So this is how that kind of escalation happened. So in 1988, Congress authorized the death penalty only for two major crimes. This is the low end for intentional murder by a drug trafficker and intentionally killing a police officer. And then in the 101st Congress, it initiated this way to a kind of moving away from crime-specific consideration of which crimes, totally decoupled from any kind of measure of deterrence, prevalence, what's for the net good, and actually just moving towards the numbers. So you get this kind of bidding where in January 89, Thurman proposes 22 crimes punishable by death, and then Biden comes in a few months later and says, no, I actually think it should be 34. And then in the next Congress, Bush Thurman proposes 46 punishable by death, and then Biden steps in and says, no, it actually needs to be 51. And then it goes up and gets bidded up all the way to 64, so that by the time it's at that high number, Clinton's successful proposal allows Democrats to boast that the liberal wing of the Democratic Party is now for more than 60 new death penalties. The liberal wing of the Democratic Party has 70 enhanced penalties, and the liberal wing of the Democratic Party is for 100,000 new cops. The liberal wing of the Democratic Party is for 125,000 new state prison cells. And this was a rhetoric not only of this sort of triumphalism of punishment, but without any kind of reference points to its purpose, who it's going to capture. This is a dynamic that is capturing not only the Democratic moment of aggressive distancing from Black interests, which is one of the themes we get from Paul Frymer's work, for example, but it also illustrates a kind of procedural protection that allows the Democratic Party to still say, we're covering in the best kind of coverage that you're going to get. To conclude, I think that most conversations around the development of the carceral state begin by noting some kind of puzzling exceptionalism. It's exceptional, it's strange to note the growth of the carceral state because it's so tenuously connected to crime rates. It's a departure from traditional Federalist divisions. It's a puzzle in terms of what some think of as a conventional narrative of racial progress. But I think actually all of these puzzles of federal crime policy begin to fade when we view law and order itself not as a backlash against civil rights, but actually the very progeny of civil rights as liberal lawmakers defined them from the very start. So we get stories here that are actually quite similar to the stories that we get with educational transformation and a variety of civil rights reforms, in which you have a first moment, which is a moment of liberal roots, a wide opening of a policy definition that is then just transformed into a vision of state building, gutted of any kind of commitment to principles, and finally a moment in which the original terms of justice, that is protection from violence, are subverted against the very people who are advocating for it most aggressively, so that I now think it's fair to argue that the carceral state itself, so hulking and mammoth, is the thing that actually poses the greatest threat to safety and security of person. I think this is a common story with civil rights institutionalization. And I'll conclude by thinking about Kim Crenshaw's point that every victory also entails a loss, and the building of the civil rights carceral state is a moment where we need to be as wary of the victories as we need to be of the losses.
Yes, I'd like to invite our panelists to come back up. So this was a wide-ranging and provocative set of arguments that we've heard today. We have about 20 minutes for questions, and so I'd like to open this up to the audience to engage with any of our panelists.
Yes. I'm here from Trenton, New Jersey. I'm one of the organizers there in the city, and I came specifically to hear something that I could take back to Trenton to my fellow organizers and say, well, look, this is what we got to do. So what would be your recommendations for me to take back?
Do you want to start, or?
I think that there's been too much focus on how we make people exiting prisons feel a little better when they get back. Instead of talking about why do we have, you know, 1 in 3 black men entering these institutions, taking breadwinners out of their communities, disrupting social capital, disrupting their chances. So I would say the model that I ended on, justice reinvestment, is taking place now in 15 states. And there's a federal bill before the Senate that the Judiciary Committee has now approved on a Criminal Justice Reinvestment Act, which would not fund the COPS program, not fund these terrible Edward Byrne JAG grants, which basically pumped billions of dollars into states so that they could revise their criminal justice system, which ultimately meant more cops, more enforcement strategies that led to more incarceration. So I would say lobby for the passage of that act, which would finally get at the criminogenic conditions, the reasons why those communities have lots of abandoned houses, the reasons why they don't have community gardens and parks and things for youngsters to do besides, you know, hang out on the corner. I would also say that because that's a community-based change, in other words, it's saying do not give more to cops, give it directly, give the savings directly to community-based organizations, nonprofit and private sector alike, and 15 states are doing that. I don't think that New Jersey is one of those states. I would talk to Todd Clear, who is at Rutgers and who is trying to get those programs up and running. That Trenton and New Jersey in particular has many cities in which that type of reinvestment model would do wonders for both communities, stopping the feeder population. It's basically diverting funds from jails and cops and giving it back to the communities and where they need it. So I would say lobby for that, get that up and running in Trenton. Other local communities have done it, and it's worked. And it's not only saved state and locality millions of dollars in incarceration, it's also created schools, created businesses where there were none before, created private sector incentives to hire ex-offenders. That would be my suggestion.
I would focus, especially in the period of economic downturn, on the kinds of divisions that we find within the middle class that I was talking about, and to think about how we can target local and federal policies to help people in the bottom category that I've been talking about and below. So we have, for example, the $8,000 tax credit for buying a home works well for people in the top two categories because they can afford to buy homes. It doesn't work as well in this economy for people in the lower category. Right? So how do we think about ways to pull people up the class ladder? There are other policies as well. In Ann Arbor, everyone is replacing their windows and getting waterless, tankless water heaters because there are rebates for those kinds of home improvements too. But most people in Ann Arbor had the money to do those kinds of things and they don't really need the rebate. So again, it's a day for me to say unpopular things, but you know, I think we have to think about maybe reducing some of the benefits and goodies that we're giving to people at the top of that class ladder and expanding some of the opportunities for people closer to the bottom.
My temptation is to say you probably know more than most already. You're doing the work of community organizing, right? And so I wouldn't presume to add a lot, but that by being in close contact with people most affected and, you know, a sincere commitment that is not overly strategic, might be my own. That's my humble recommendation.
You know, that sounds almost like go for principle and don't play politics.
I would say that the classic way of playing politics has failed.
I just had a question for Karyn, which is, do the people in, was it Sherwood Park is the really elite enclave?
Mm-hmm.
Do they see their enclave as elite in relationship to Lakeview, as well as to the sort of middle category for blacks? And do the people in Lakeview see, like, would whites want to move mm-hmm. from Lakeview to Sherwood Park? And then, like, the follow-up is, do the kids in Sherwood Park go to school with the kids in the sort of less prestigious black neighborhood, Riverton, or, you know, so what's going on there? Mm-hmm. And then I'm wondering, in light of all the things that we've been reading, all the myths about how, you know, poor people destroyed, you know, global capitalism in the last 5 years because they got these sort of, you know, exploding mortgages. What do they call the mortgages? The subprime loans, right? And, like, you know, it's not Goldman Sachs. It's that, you know, that person in the category, that 35 to 49,000 category that wanted that first house. They ruined America. Like, you know, that narrative that we've been hearing endlessly, right? Like, I wonder, what are the differences? Andrea and I were puzzling over why the whites in that category are so much better off in terms of housing. Mm-hmm. Is it because of inherited wealth? Like, what are the, mm-hmm. the stories there?
Those are good questions. The Sherwood Park community has an interesting history. When suburbanization began in PG County, middle class blacks were just spilling over the DC border and they were moving into the inner suburbs of PG County. But then as more blacks started to move in, developers began to construct subdivisions specifically for middle class and upper middle class blacks who were moving into the community. So Sherwood Park started out as a clean slate. The developers installed a white sales staff, and everyone who interviewed told me that, you know, if the developers protect white homeowners, then, or white community, then they will install a white sales staff. Mm-hmm. So they did, and whites started to buy in Sherwood Park, even though it is ensconced in heavily black PG County. But what happened was blacks started to drive by and then look over and said, what is this? These are homes that are on an acre of land. They're huge homes. They're beautiful. At the time that this community was constructed, which was in the late 1980s, these homes were selling in the mid-threes, which was very expensive at that time for a home. And blacks started coming in and saying, I want to live here too. Well, as you might imagine, the whites who had already invested in this community started to get upset, right? The developers switched the sales staff over from a white sales staff to an entirely black sales staff. So that created two groups of whites in this community. One group who had moved in before the racial composition of the community was decided, and they thought they were going to be living in a majority white or at least a not-so-black community. And then a second group of whites who moved in much later who knew exactly what they were getting themselves into. They knew most of the neighbors were going to be black and they wanted an integrated community. So the perception within Riverton is, among Sherwood Park residents, is that the rest of Riverton is the black ghetto, and they actually describe it in those terms, and that their community is the elite community. But the blacks in Sherwood Park also realized that whites on the other side of the Potomac and Fairfax County don't elevate their community to the status that they believe it deserves. So PG County is stigmatized more generally, and whites who don't really travel to Maryland haven't spent enough time there to know that there's a lot of variation in terms of the housing stock. So what happens is the kids who are in private schools in Sherwood Park have their friends come over, and the friends go, you know what, the little kids, wow, I didn't know this was over here. And their parents say, their parents have the same kind of reaction. So we were talking earlier about, what it might take to change the hearts and minds of white people, and I think some of it is getting out of your comfort zone and having more interactions with minority groups. It's very easy in this country to live, even in a place like Atlanta, to live in a white world and never have any contact with black people. So they'd have to move out of their comfort zone. And I don't really want to touch the question of whether lower middle class blacks have ruined the economy.
Well, we know it's not true, but I mean, it's just, my point was, is the perception of, that group in the bottom, sort of where are the whites getting the money to buy the houses versus, the and so I just wondered if you,
mm-hmm.
Seen it, yeah.
The foreclosure figures in PG County are pretty high.
Yeah. I think what Tom Shapiro calls transformative wealth is a part of the story, right? That whites more often than blacks have inherited wealth from parents and grandparents that they use not only for down payments for homes, but for private schooling, for cars and other luxury items that they wouldn't be able to afford on their income alone. So that's certainly part of the story.
Hi, Carol Brooks, James News and Jay Glover. Prior to the two panels on the Iranian side, we talked about the prison industry. We had a think tank last week. We had 10 individuals from the ages of 60 to 18 over my house discussing the prison industry. And about 90% believe that they were someone college educated, high school, didn't graduate, all around. Believe that there should be some type of movement and against the justice system as it happened in the 60s and 70s, mm-hmm. even to the point of what they saw in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
And there are individuals who said, yeah, that's what we need. Because they don't believe that this type of a system isn't going to get any better. And what do you think about that, since we see that movements have actually, 60s movements, what's happening around the world, have really changed things within 3 to 4 years, overnight. And is that a possibility because of what they have done to the majority of African Americans that are in prison and jail all across the country?
Honestly, I think it's actually the only way that this nation will have a serious discussion about why so many blacks are having this type of contact. I mean, and it's not even, I read something recently by Jeff Fagan, where he estimated the probability of being stopped in New York City, where these Terry stops have increased 500%, and it was 99% for 18 to 19-year-old black men. 99%, meaning you just can't move through that city being a 18-year-old black man and not get stopped by police. And then he looked at, well, maybe that's because some people are getting stopped multiple times and it's just within, 30% of that population. Even accounting for that, it was still something like 76% probability of being stopped. I think that nothing, and I said this at lunch, nothing short of a modern day, I'm going to call it a civil rights revolution, but it might be something different, some sort of mass-based movement where middle-class blacks and whites need to recognize that their lower-class counterparts are facing a crisis. It is the, next to probably AIDS, it is the biggest crisis in lower-class black America. And until that recognition happens, we can fiddle around with, getting rid of the drug zone, laws. We can fiddle around with, maybe retracting the 100-to-1 crack disparity. Lots of states are doing lots of things, but it's not going to get us back to the level that we were at 30 years ago. And another way to think about this is that, and our colleague pointed this out to the other day, and I was shocked by it, black Americans have only really had 15 years in this country of enfranchisement.
Mm-hmm.
They've only really had 15 years of it, because there are more blacks disenfranchised today than the day of the 15th Amendment, that the 15th Amendment was passed. So I think nothing short of that will change anything. Unfortunately, and not to end on a pessimistic note, you know, we asked a lot of our interviewees, why isn't there more people protesting this in your communities? If you know no one that has not had this contact, how is it that, you know, people aren't upset, angry, rioting, doing something? And the consistent answer we got was, they're not going to listen to us. They've already deemed us offenders. Like, you've got to have a name. You've got to be Al Sharpton. They're not going to listen to us. We don't have a name. You know, one even started singing the lyrics of Money, Power, Respect. You know, that song, you know, is the key to life. And they didn't have it. So they couldn't, I mean, even banding together would do nothing. They would be written off as black criminals. So I think what I'm trying to say is that the institution of criminal justice itself has collapsed a collective mentality that would allow people to even take a movement, take to the streets. You know, most people walk around extremely stigmatized and shameful of this experience. They're not going, hey, you've had this experience too.
Right.
Let's band together. Let's do something. They don't feel like their politicians will listen to them. They have records.
We have time for one more question.
I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry.
So, yes. And also, you know, in this sort of history of reformist reform, the message that keeps coming across is everything that people think is going to be the fix is not the fix, right? Miranda rights were supposed to be huge. It was supposed to slow down processing and really take a hit at police brutality. Now it's mostly just a cover for police departments and lawsuits. Right? It barely even generates more paperwork for them. So the history of just sort of generating reformist reform in this, the only language that is going to help us to move away from that is actually a language of abolition.
I don't want to be the last question, but I just wanted to ask this question to each of the panelists, because I think each one of you was, in interesting sorts of ways, very provocative, right? So I want to try to make explicit the provocation. Right? In terms of the kind of differentiation within the middle class, in Karyn's talk, would you say a little bit more about what seems to, it seems that those African Americans who are at the upper end have gained access with every indice that the differential was statistically negligible, but it wasn't to me statistically significant. It just seems to me that you're making a particular sort of claim around a particular cadre or subsection of Black America that's doing very well, that actually gets lumped into something else, and it seems to me that you're trying to suggest something about internal class politics that I would love to hear more about. It's not just simply description going on. There's a normative claim implicit in what you're suggesting. In terms of Vesla's your talk, I'm wondering what happens with your emphasis on citizenship, because there's a way in which the carceral state, in relation to immigrant populations, is their understanding of government. Right. So what happens when you narrow it to questions of citizenship and anti-citizenship, right? What happens to those folks who are migrating to the U.S. and they're encountering, right, the U.S. as, in fact, the carceral state? And I'm thinking about those folks who are caught up through immigration, I mean, carceral.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about, right? And then Naomi, are you suggesting that we understand contemporary liberal policies as not just simply being complicitous, but actually being central to the sedimentation of the new racial regime that furthers the marginalization of people of color, and particularly African Americans? And if so, what then are you calling for? Because it seems like that kind of black, whether it's mainstream American neoliberalism, or whether it's black neoliberalism, it's the order of the day.
Mm-hmm.
So if each of you could kind of address each one of these for me, I would be really interested in hearing. Sorry, I couldn't make that more articulate.
Mm-hmm. I should say up front that the people who are classified in the top category, I call it the elite black middle class, didn't want to be there. I put them there when I posed the question to them. They describe themselves as middle class. The problem is that in terms of their income, in terms of their behavior, and a number of other measures, that they actually are not regular middle class people. They are much more like an elite middle class, and I'll tell you what some of those measures are in a moment. But the problem for them is that they know, they understand the concept of linked fate, even though they don't use that terminology. And so they know that they're supposed to think about their life chances and their experiences in terms of the opportunities that are available to the average black, right? What is the average black neighborhood? What is the average black experience on the labor market and so forth? But that understanding is in tension with their conceptions of how far they've come. And there's a lot of pride for them in their success and also astonishment. So I interviewed a number of people who said, you know, I'm more successful than I ever thought that I would be, right? So, you know, they have a home that they never thought they would be able to afford. Their kids are enrolled in schools that, you know, their parents would turn over in their graves if they knew how much, you know, these schools cost. So in that sense, their lives are better than anything they could have ever dreamed, right? And so because of that, they're not only very critical of people in the groups below them, but they're also, they tend to turn a blind eye to some of the discriminatory practices that are still apparent in society. So what are some examples? So one is, you know, there was a guy who, his neighbor put a living room couch out on the porch. This was before he moved to Sherwood Park in his previous neighborhood. And he told me he thought his neighbor was going to throw the couch away, but the person brought it there to sit on. And he, you know, just as a piece of porch frame, and he was mortified, right? So, now you might think, what is that really hurting anything, right? So the person sits there, porches, you know, who cares, right? But this is very important to him in terms of what that couch on the porch said about his neighborhood and about him and what that signaled to other people. So they're not only differences in terms of income, but those income differences dictate other kinds of distinctions that members of the elite group express. All the while denying that they were anything but middle class.
You know, I think that I don't mean to use the word citizen. I think what I mean, I don't mean literal citizen. In other words, I'm not talking about, you know, we have people in our interviews who were likely undocumented or likely not naturalized yet. So we did interview Latinos who were not citizens. What I mean when I say custodial citizen, and when I ask, you know, what does it mean to be a custodial citizen or to have a custodial life world, what I mean by that is, how are they thinking about the state, equality, their standing, I should say. Maybe I should, you know, replace standing for citizen. When theirs is a government that monitors them, that punishes them, theirs is a government to be avoided, not participated in. So I think I'm not, you know, I don't mean that we're excluding people that are not citizens at all. And in fact, I think that there's probably a lot of similarity between Latinos who have been increasingly stopped under Section 287G requirements that basically deputize localities to act as immigration enforcement officers. And I'm sure that theirs is the same sort of, the same sort of process happens. When they have that sort of encounter, and when they're questioned, and when they're suspected by the state, that their standing in the civic and democratic community shifts. They're seeing the different side of the state. They're seeing a more punitive government, a government that is not responsive to them, a government where they're not making claims and making demands that their leaders respond to them, but one that should be distanced, that should be avoided at all costs. I don't want to, you know. And we had a lot of people, a lot of blacks who actually compared themselves to immigrants that come to this country from other places, and they'd say, you know, look, I feel like they're better citizens than I am. I feel like they can come to this country, they can get their tax credits, they can get home loans, they can do anything they want to achieve the American dream. And I'm here, and I've been working all my life, and I've been contributing to the Social Security system or whatever. And I can't. I'm you know, not as good a citizen as they are. And for many, the loss of citizen rights, the loss of the right to vote, was a very critical and traumatic moment for them. You know, we had one guy say, "I'll never be a true American citizen again. I'll be living in this country, breathing, eating, walking around. And I'll never be that again." And so it signified something very great about losing what it meant to be an American citizen. And so I think that that's why I keep coming back to this notion of citizenship, even though I don't mean the literal you're legally here or you're not. Mm-hmm. I mean more something like belonging in a civic community or your standing in America.
Vesla, I'm sorry, just a thought. It sounds like half freedom. Like the concept that Jennifer Morgan, the historian, uses. I mean, that
you know, it's interesting because one of our people in New Orleans, in describing government to me, I said, "What does government mean to you? How would you describe it in your own terms?" Just, you know, and I'm expecting him to say, you know, the president, Congress, the judiciary, you know, whatever, political parties. This is what we learn in our government textbooks, right? And he says to me, government is like freedom, but not freedom. We're free, but we're not free. And that sort of same sentiment, maybe not in those words, came up again and again and again.
Your slavery references, too.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. They saw the, you know, basically a racial order that hadn't really shifted that much. It might be a little bit different on the surface, but it wasn't, you know, freedom, but not freedom.
So yes, I do think liberals were not only complicitous, but in fact pivotal to building the carceral state with an eye towards generating racial calm rather than racial justice. And I do understand that that leaves us in a lurch in terms of what we think of as a classic left-right dialogue amongst policymakers. So, you know, I think I would say it's similar to what other people have said today, which is that the reference points that we're using for a good aren't that helpful to us. So the notion of civil rights as it's used by federal policymakers right now is actually not a very helpful reference, and that if we actually start putting forward ideas of what does it mean to nurture a healthy adolescence as a standard, or standard of what does it mean to actually minimize violence and sickness and harm on the body, would actually be one of the biggest ways of striking a blow against the carceral state, or even reclaiming notions of law and order, really, if you were to look in, I mean, and re-centralizing harm, actual harm, and where actual harm comes from. So in the 20th century, you have to think that probably Ida B. Wells was the most persuasive advocate of law and order. It was just not the vision of law and order that we got. And then in the 21st century, you probably have to think that Goldman Sachs has done more harm than almost any serial murder, but that's also not the way we're measuring harm, right? And the more we go to actual reference points to a good that we want, rather than abstracted notions of what we might imagine to be fair, the better off.
So this has been an incredibly provocative and stimulating conversation. I know many of you still had questions, and I hope you'll come up and engage with the panelists individually. This has been, in many ways, a very sobering conversation, but I'm left hopeful knowing that these great minds are bringing the best of the tools of social science to bear on these important questions of public policy, and so I'd like to thank them for these efforts.
Coming over to hang out with us.
Yeah.